the Philippines.
And we are ANC.
Outgoing Agriculture Chief William Dar expects a bigger budget for the agency with President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. at its helm.
A local research group sees daily COVID cases in Metro Manila hitting 1,000 next month.
European countries' eyes shifting to coal due to reduced gas supplies from Russia.
And Russian journalist Dmitry Muratov auctions off his Nobel Peace Prize gold medal to benefit the children displaced by the war in Ukraine.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Cruz.
And I'm Denise Insight.
You're watching Top Story. Outgoing Philippine Agriculture Secretary William Dar welcomes the decision of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. to take over the department. Dar believes it will be beneficial for the agency. With Marcos at the helm, Dar is expecting a bigger budget for the agriculture department.
His resolve to take the reins is a strong indication of this. We are confident this will augur an unprecedented whole of government movement for the urgent attainment of food security and or food sovereignty in this time of crisis. Muli, ang buong kagawaran ng pagsasaka ay handa sa pagdating ng ating bagong halal na Pangulo Ferdinand R. Marcos Jr. bilang kalihim ng pagsasaka. We see this pronouncement as a victory of the Department of Agriculture in rousing broad public support towards the sector's rehabilitation and empowerment.
Dar is confident Marcos is capable of addressing the looming food crisis and other problems in the sector.
There is this global food crisis. More than 20 countries have now made restrictions on the exports of their food products. And the lingering war in Ukraine continues. So there is really major disruption of food supply chain. And so this is a big problem. If I have to equate this is like a pandemic as well.
For former Agriculture Secretary Leonardo Montemayor, President-elect Marcos proves he's determined to address issues hounding the agriculture sector. But he also has some concerns.
Kasi siyempre pagka-presidente yung pinaka-secretary ng department, baka mag-aalinlangan po yung mga nasa ilalim niya na mag-decide. Kasi kung baga, they might be playing some of them might be playing a wait and see attitude, di ba? There will be some of them might be hesitant to make decisions because presidente ang kanilang boss eh. So I hope that can be addressed somehow. Then I think it will also be helpful to the president elect if he will choose a good second layer of subordinate officials under him, because I suppose he will not spend most of his time in the Department of Agriculture. But like in Malacanang, so paano po yung decision making at the below his level, those are things that will require some degree of immediate attention. Kung dadalhin pa sa Malacanang, baka magkaroon ng time delay.
Agriculture group Sinag meanwhile hopes having the president as the DA chief could eliminate corruption and curb smuggling in the sector.
From the start of the farmers planting, there's already corruption. Egg fertilizer has emerged in these few months. So I think the president should help because of the farmers is buying fake fertilizer. And of course, our borders control from other country. We don't have any border control. Smuggling continues to come in.
Several Philippine senators also cheering President-elect Marcos's move. Senator Sunny Angara notes the decision is, well, within the prerogative of the next Philippine leader, since all cabinet secretaries are considered his alter egos. Senator-elect Francis Escudero, meanwhile, believes the move could cut a lot of red tape. He also expects government resources to be at the disposal of the agriculture agency. For Senator-elect J.V. Ejercito, this sends a strong message agencies under the DA should get their acts together. And Senator-elect Jinggoy Estrada says he expects prompt action on problems in the agriculture sector as Marcos leads the agency.
A Filipino teachers' group hopes Vice President-elect and incoming Education Chief Sara Duterte will prioritize pay hikes in their sector. The Teachers' Dignity Coalition says the salary scheme for teachers should be reviewed in the next administration. The group says they have requested a dialogue with Duterte on the matter.
Sana po, no? Sana naman po this time po ay magkatotoo na po ito, no? Kasi every election na pinapangako naman ito sa amin, no? But this time, of course, no? A sitting vice president would also lead the Department of Education as its secretary. Eh, medyo ibang istorya po ito, no? Ibig sabihin, lahat po ng issue ng education sector and in particular ng DepEd, no, ay isang magiging sentro ito ng atensyon, magiging pambansang issue at hindi na po mawawalang bahala sana.
A political analyst lays fears the incoming Philippine Education Secretary could use her post to change history taught in classes. Professor Froilan Calilong sees Vice President-elect Sara Duterte as a principled leader who does not support what she believes is not right. President-elect Marcos's decision to appoint Duterte as education chief raised concerns that changes would be made in the teaching of history, especially on the martial law regime of his late father.
If the decision, I believe, will boil down to, you know, purely historical revisionism without the necessary pragmatic and empirical basis, I think Vice President Sara Duterte will hold her ground on that, and for the truth to, you know, still remain as it is.
Vice President-elect Sara Duterte taps lawyer Reynold Munsayak as her new spokesperson. Attorney Munsayak will replace Liloan Mayor Cristina Frasco, who is set to head the Tourism Department under the Marcos administration. In 2021, Munsayak resigned as Commissioner and Acting Chairman of the Presidential Commission on Good Government to help campaign for Duterte Carpio. They were also classmates in law school. Malacanang yet to confirm if President Rodrigo Duterte accepts the offer to be the legal consultant of his former aide, Senator Bongo. But acting palace spokesperson Martin Andanar says he would not be surprised if Duterte does so. The lawmaker earlier said Duterte already confirmed his willingness to take the position after he steps down from office.
Officially, right now, wala akong natanggap na pahayag mula kay Presidente na willing siya maging legal advisor ni Senator Bongo. Pero kanina may nakita ako sa social media na lumabas na willing di umano. But again, as one of the closest friends of the President, si Senator Bongo, siyempre mentor siya ni Senator Bongo, I wouldn't be surprised kung if he will be amenable to become a legal advisor of the senator.
The palace also says that based on reports, President Duterte has rejected the offer to be the anti-illegal drug czar of the incoming Marcos administration.
Outgoing Vice President Leni Robredo lays down more programs that she will pursue when her term ends on June 30th. Now, for more on this, let's now talk to her spokesperson, Attorney Barry Gutierrez. Attorney Barry, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Rod.
Nice to talk to you again. Now, the Vice President is planning to launch a campaign and initiatives against fake news and misinformation. We can understand where that could be coming from, since studies showed she was on the end of those before and during the elections. But is this going to be personal for her? Is this her way of possibly getting back at those who maligned her?
I don't think it's an attempt to get back at anyone. I think that it's personal in the sense that she has direct experience in being on the receiving end of, you know, a vicious and relentless fake news campaign. We spent a lot of time the past 6 years during her term as vice president having to correct and you know, point out fake news that was continuously directed against her, against her projects, against her own family. So, you know, she knows firsthand how pernicious this particular problem is. And therefore, when she announced her plans that she would be pursuing after her term ends on June 30, this was one of the initiatives that she indicated she would be interested in actually taking a hand in, which is working on counter disinformation, trying to make particularly the social media platforms more accountable, and perhaps strengthening the capacity of Filipinos to be more discerning in the materials that they are exposed to on social media, to be able to distinguish more effectively between, you know, what is fake news and what is actually fact, whether that's on social media or in any other platform that they receive their information.
Has it continued, the attacks and of misinformation against the vice president and her family after the campaign?
Yes, that's actually one of the well, maybe not surprising, but alarming things, that despite the fact that supposedly the campaign is over, that she is actually just in the last few days of her term as VP, the attacks against her have continued. They range from false allegations regarding, you know, a supposed flight which caused the caused delays at the airport, which was proven to be false, and other things, even some relating to her daughter. So this is really something which is unrelenting. This is really a problem that affects not only the vice president but a lot of Filipinos and, you know, citizens in general. And so long as we operate in an environment, we live in a social media environment where fake news is rampant, and as a result, millions of our fellow citizens get false information and they base decisions on this false information that they get, then that's a threat to our democracy. That's a threat to our institutions and our way of life. So this is really something that she takes very seriously. And, you know, she's very determined and keen to pursue this as one of the projects she will undertake after her term ends.
Aside from those activities that you mentioned a while ago to counter misinformation, is she planning legal action against those who continue to attack her, to malign her?
Well, we've talked to several lawyers groups, many of which we came into contact with during the campaign as volunteers. And we have had initial discussions on the possibility of pursuing cases, legal action, in order to further this particular advocacy against disinformation and fake news. So that's filing cases will definitely be something that we will explore and possibly pursue, if not against individual people who are responsible for the spread of fake news, then also possibly against the platforms themselves, to hold them more accountable in enforcing a higher standard of truth and accuracy on anything that actually is spread within the platforms that they administer.
Media has been trying to put out fires itself, and it has been very, very difficult to contain the spread of misinformation. How is the vice president going to do it, and how are you going to be sure that it's going to be more effective, that it's going to be effective in countering the misinformation and the spread of fake news?
Well, first of all, we won't be starting from zero. There have been conversations between the Vice President and her team with other institutions, other individuals who have been attempting, as you said, to combat fake news over the past few years. So the first thing that we are doing right now is in fact taking meetings, coordinating with these other groups to find out what initiatives, what interventions have proven and will probably continue to prove the most effective. We are planning to actually convene a greater number of people who are interested in being part of this particular initiative to take a hand. As you said, one of the avenues we're exploring is really the legal avenue. And I think that that has been underutilized in this entire endeavor over the course of the past few years. Another will really be on the policy making side, where we will try to get laws enacted, if not in the Philippines, then in other jurisdictions, in order to hold the platforms to a higher standard of accountability insofar as the information that appears on their platforms is concerned. And then lastly, you have the education part, which I think is also a bit underdeveloped at this point. We really need to take a more proactive and aggressive approach in teaching more citizens, more Filipinos, how to distinguish between fake news and real news, how to distinguish between disinformation and the real information. So this is going to be a multi-level effort. There will be efforts to pull in more stakeholders and more advocates, some of whom have already been part of these initiatives in past years, and hopefully that will be that will lead to greater success on this front. And one thing the Vice President brings really is her capacity to bring people together. She has stature as a former VP. She has a very, very extensive network of people from various fields and various backgrounds whose expertise can actually be brought to bear on this problem. And, it's something that we need that needs to be done. If we do not address this going forward, then it will continue to bedevil elections. It will continue to bedevil issues like public accountability, and it will hamper public discourse, which is essential in any democracy.
And you're going to build on the momentum that you had also from the campaign, tapping the public, tapping the civilians as individuals, for this fight against misinformation, the one that Mrs. Robredo also sparked, that wave of volunteerism that she had in campaign. She's going to use this for this program.
Definitely. In fact, as early as the day we had the Thanksgiving rally at the Ateneo, which was just the end of the of election week, the moment she actually indicated that she would be pursuing as one of her projects after the her term ends, an anti-disinformation initiative, there was immediately a tremendous amount of interest expressed from the ranks of volunteers, from supporters, from people active in the campaign. And, as you said, definitely that kind of energy, that kind of enthusiasm is something that we will try to tap and maximize for this particular project.
Okay, now you have this campaign, Mrs. Robredo will have this campaign against misinformation, and then she'll also be busy with the Angat Buhay program that she wants to continue. Any other more projects that she wants to take up?
Well, right now, those are the two main initiatives that she is pursuing, and I think that that's already a lot on her plate. She has been very, very clear that on July 1, we will be launching the Angat Buhay NGO. And by itself, that's a program that will really require a lot of effort and a lot of time and energy. We will be attempting to continue a project which she started as Vice President. But this time, She will be wearing the hat of a private citizen. So that's definitely going to be a challenge. But similar to the Anti-Disinformation Initiative, there has been a lot of interest and a lot of expressions of support and people saying that they will volunteer for this effort. So we're optimistic. This is going to involve a lot of work, but we think that using the momentum of the campaign, continuing to tap the tremendous amount of volunteerism that emerged during the last 7 months leading up to the May 9 elections, you know, we can make this work. And the Vice President is excited to start this next chapter in her career in public service.
Quickly on another issue, Attorney Barry. Now, Mrs. Robredo did not attend the oath taking of Vice President-elect Sara Duterte Carpio. This was because of scheduled meetings, according to you. But we're curious what those meetings were. Did they have anything to do with the Angat Buhay program and this campaign against disinformation? What else is keeping the Vice President busy in her last days as Vice President?
She was unable to attend because June 18, the day before the scheduled oath taking, was Naga City Charter Day. Mm-hmm. So she had already been scheduled to be in Naga the day before. So as a consequence of that, there were multiple other events scheduled for her in Naga and in Camarines Sur and in the Bicol region in more generally, because, you know, taking advantage of her presence in her home province. So these were meetings that mostly involved talking to you know, local supporters, organizations that she had been working with for a long time, from the time that she was already in Congress, and even administering oaths of incoming mm-hmm. Local officials in Camarines Sur. So this was really more along the lines of going back home and taking a lot of meetings and attending activities related to local events.
So it was nothing against Vice President-elect Sara Duterte. Won't they have any one-on-one meeting anymore?
Well, she informed the incoming vice president, the vice president elect, that she would not be able to attend, and the reasons why she would not be able to attend. And also, we will be holding our final general assembly on June 27 at the OVP. And I believe she also extended an invitation to the vice president elect to attend or be present at that event. If she wants, so you know, she's the transition teams have been working closely together to ensure a smooth transition, and if possible, then the two of them could meet personally. And as I said, the latest effort in that regard, the newest opportunity is on June 27, where she extended an invitation to the Vice President-elect to attend the final General Assembly under her term.
Okay. Oh, one more thing. The radio program of the Vice President, Biserbisyong Lenny, will it continue
yes.
after she steps down?
Right now, it's scheduled to have its last episode this coming Sunday, and the Vice President will be there to attend the last episode. So far, that's the plan. That particular show will be discontinued. But you know, moving forward, if it's possible for her to have another show, another venue. For getting her message out, then, you know, that's something that we'll probably explore.
Attorney Barry Gutierrez, a spokesperson of Vice President Lenny Robredo. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Ron. Always a pleasure to be here. And stay safe.
The Octa Research Group believes there is a possibility Metro Manila will be put in moderate risk by the end of June due to the increase in COVID cases. The country has averaged 436 daily cases from June 13th to 19th, which is higher by 82% from the week before that. Over the weekend, the Department of Health said the capital region might tally up to 1,200 infections a day by the end of June. OCTA also projects daily COVID cases in Metro Manila to hit 1,000 in the coming weeks.
225 cases yung 7-day average sa Metro Manila. Possible itong tumaas between 500 and 1,000in by end of June or first week of July. So pag ganyan, masasabi na natin baka nasa moderate risk yung situation natin. Although kahit naman moderate risk, yung pinakami na monitor natin for alert levels, yung hospital utilization.
With infections rising, Health Secretary Francisco Duque approves the recommendation allowing children aged 12 to 17 to receive booster shots. In an amended emergency use authorization issued to Pfizer, the Food and Drug Administration has allowed a third dose for the age group 6 months after completing the primary series. But the guidelines for additional shots have yet to be released. Dr. Nina Gloriani, the head of the country's vaccine expert panel, says more parents are open to giving their kids booster shots.
Medyo may ilang buwan na rin na napigay natin yung primary series nila, yung waning immunity, plus of course may banta pa rin nung mga variants or sub-variants of concern natin. And we want also na mag-normalize na pati ang mga bata natin, mga anak natin, ako. I think okay naman sila kasi nga gusto nila na ang mga bata makapasok na rin face-to-face. And then syempre, iniisip natin lahat yan. Mas magiging mobile ang mga tao and we really have to normalize soon.
The Interior Department hopes a ramped-up COVID vaccination program will continue in the next administration. Interior Undersecretary Martin Dino says efforts to increase vaccination coverage across the Philippines continue with just days left before President Rodrigo Duterte's term ends. He also reminds the public and local government units to continue following the existing COVID protocols.
Wala tayong tigil dyan, ano? Tuloy-tuloy ang ating pagbabakuna, lalong-lalo na doon sa mga lugar na talagang mababa, ano? Ang ating vaccine, at tuloy-tuloy pa rin yung ating kampanya na talagang ang panlaban dito sa COVID-19 ay ang bakuna lang talaga. Kaya nasabi nga natin, ngayon tapos na tayo dun sa mga fully vaccinated. Nandito na tayo ngayon sa booster dahil ito na ang pinopromote natin, lalong-lalo na pinaghahandaan natin. Actually, may order kami na tignan lahat ng mga hindi pa nagbabakuna at the same time, inganyuhin sila na magpapakuna at ito lang talaga ang ating, sabi nga, yung mga walang bakuna, yan ang delikado pag tinamaan.
A group of medical frontliners threatens to file cases if government fails to release their benefits and allowances. The Private Hospital Workers Alliance of the Philippines says many of their members have yet to receive their one COVID allowance. Some of them are from big hospitals like the Medical City and Calamba Medical Center. The group fears workers from smaller hospitals are also affected.
Nakakatakot tano, kabayan, kaya nananawagan ako lalo na sa bandang Laguna po. Kasi kung ang pinakamalaki nilang ospital ay itong Calamba Medical Center, paano pa po yung mga maliliit na mga ospital na ununionized pa? So, ibig sabihin, lalong hindi nakakatanggap yun. Eh kung tutuusin, sinasabi ng DOH, downloaded na doon sa mga CHD, saan ngayon yung pondo?
Up next, the mayor of Philadelphia blames the lack of gun control measures for the fatal shooting of a visiting Filipino lawyer.
And European countries eye switching to coal amid reduced gas flows from Russia. More news when we return.
Back with more news. A fatal shooting of a Filipino lawyer in Philadelphia could be a case of mistaken identity. Citing police sources, Philippine Consul General in New York, El Mercato, said the gunman appeared to have fired at the wrong vehicle that was similar to what he was chasing. John Albert Lilo was riding in an Uber with his mother when he was shot in the head Saturday. They were on their way to the Philadelphia International Airport. He died hours after the incident. Lilo was in the U.S. to visit his relatives.
The mayor of Philadelphia blames the lack of gun control measures in the U.S. for Lilo's deadly shooting. On Twitter, Mayor Jim Kenney wrote, "The incident is another horrific example of the tragic impact of the prevalence of guns in their city." Kenney also said, "Senseless violence will always be unacceptable, and Philadelphia authorities are on top of the situation." The Filipino community in Philadelphia, meanwhile, held a vigil for Lilo.
Over in New Zealand, several Filipinos were among those who died in a road crash in Pictonstown. Authorities say 7 people were killed in the incident, among them a baby. They were on their way home after attending a funeral when the van they were riding on collided with a truck. An investigation is underway. On Facebook, Philippine Ambassador to New Zealand Gary Domingo said the embassy is assisting the family of the victims.
Back here at home, the Metropolitan Manila Development Authority does not see the need to further expand the number coding scheme anytime soon. It says it has been monitoring a decrease in the number of vehicles using the main Metro Manila roads amid rising oil prices. The MMDA, however, says it's up to the next administration whether it will impose the expanded number coding scheme.
Nakikita po namin na wala naman pong pangangailangan sa ngayon dahil po patuloy na nababawasan ang bilang ng sasakyan sa ating lansangan at moderate pa lang naman po yung traffic. May kabuuan na pong kabawasan na 27,000 from the time na before elections. At ang tingin po namin na malaking factor dyan ay yung patuloy na pagtaas ng presyo ng produktong petrol.
Philippine shares were among the worst performers in Asia on Tuesday. Rain Musni tells us traders remained at bay ahead of the policy decision of the Philippine Central Bank.
Philippine shares sit out of an Asia-wide rally. The region's worst performer for the day, the main index fell back to the 6,200 level after shedding 0.7%. Value turnover was light and foreign selling continued. Investors stayed on the sidelines ahead of the Philippine Central Bank's policy rate setting meeting on Thursday. Nevertheless, BDO Capital's Ed Francisco believes the Monetary Board will raise rates by 25 basis points, as incoming BSP Chief Felipe Medalla had signaled.
If the economy, I guess, grows at 8-9%, then I think that will give ammunition to the Monetary Board to increase rates a little higher, right? But hearing, incoming Governor Medalla's talk yesterday, he wants to allow the economy to continue to grow. And that's why I think he's signaling that he won't increase rates as much. So, which is fair naman. So hopefully, economy grows fast, SMEs do well, then we can slowly increase rates faster.
But Ryan Perlade of First Resources Management and Securities sees a more aggressive adjustment by the BSP.
We think that the BSP will be raising the interest rate by 50 basis points on Thursday. Considering the Fed's aggressive key interest rate hike of 75 basis points and the weak peso, which breached the 54 peso level yesterday.
Meanwhile, in company news, Bloomberg and Reuters have reported that Philippine ports and gaming tycoon Enrique Razon is planning to launch an initial public offering worth up to $400 million for his energy holding company, Prime Infrastructure. They say plans for the IPO are still at an early stage, but it could happen as soon as this year.
The listing of Prime Infra will be good for Enrique Razon's business, as this should support its expansion plans. This also shows his commitment to sustainable infrastructure that will push for a resilient economy in the country.
Finally, amid plans of Globe Telecom for a 32 billion peso stock rights offer on top of a $1.5 billion tower sale, Credit Sites research analyst Jonathan Tan says these would allow the telco firm to retain strong earnings and weather competitive and external pressures.
These two events are definitely credit positives for the company. I think for Globe, let's talk about the tower sale first. I think Globe could use a large part of the 80 billion sales proceeds to fund its hefty capex, that's about 89 billion pesos. And this should then reduce the need for additional debt incurrence, and this should ease the strain on its credit profile. Now, depending on how the deal is structured, we could see some form of mild deleveraging as well. And of course, this would serve to improve its credit profile even further. Now, we just saw the Globe's board of directors approve a 32 billion peso rights issue yesterday, and the proceeds will also be used for a mix of debt repayment and capex funding. Again, this is a huge credit positive for Globe, and we could see further deleveraging and an enlarged capex funding buffer ahead. But ultimately, I think investors will be on the lookout whether the tower sale ultimately materializes.
Globe closed flat for the day after Monday's 5% decline. Rain Musngi, ABS-CBN News.
One economist believes the Philippine government should first suspend the collection of fuel excise taxes while it addresses inefficiencies in the distribution of aid. Professor Emmanuel Leco, the president of the Pamantasan ng Lungsod ng Maynila, points out the targeted support promised by government is not reaching the vulnerable sectors it seeks to help. On Monday, President-elect Bongbong Marcos says he wants to provide aid to sectors reeling from the impact of the high oil prices instead of suspending excise taxes on fuel.
Tama po si President-elect BBM. Kung efficient po ang ating gobyerno, ibig sabihin, mangulekta ka at ibigay mo doon sa tamang dapat pagbigyan. Ang problema po, may experience po tayo na mangungulekta tayo pero hindi po na ibibigay. Pinakamadali po sa ngayon ay itanggalin, suspindihin ang excise tax. At pangalawa, tingnan po natin ang ating budget, ang ating tustusin. Reviewin natin, baka naman po marami dyan sa ating budget ang hindi naman kailangang ipatupad ngayon, ipagpaliban natin. O kaya naman ay huwag na nating ituloy. Dahil taon-taon po, maraming mga ahensya ng gobyerno ang hindi po talaga nakakagastos ng mga budget nila.
For an economics professor, it's better to just provide aid instead of suspending excise tax on fuel. But Dr. Renato Reside Jr. says that aid should be more than just cash assistance for vulnerable sectors. It should also include boosting infrastructure spending, especially for the agriculture sector.
Excise tax on fuel is a very important source of government revenues. No, it's around 0.5 percentage point of GDP, and it's around 3.71% by my estimation of our total tax revenue. So that's a big chunk. Na kung tatanggalin mo yon, malaki yung mawawala sa tax revenues natin. No? And we need the tax revenues precisely because we're still in a fragile economic state. No? Our economy is just on the rebound. In fact, I think a lot of our growth now is still a lot of, we're seeing still a lot of base effects. No? And we may need a government stimulus pa moving forward. And to fund that stimulus, you need taxes.
A decision on a proposal to suspend the federal gasoline tax in the U.S. could come by the end of this week. President Joe Biden confirms he is considering the move, adding his decision will be based on data. The pause on the federal gas tax is among the options being studied by the Biden administration to control inflation and surging gas prices. The federal gas tax rate in the U.S. is at around 18 cents per gallon. Biden will also meet with oil and gas companies to discuss ways to try and bring down crude prices.
Over in Europe, Russia's biggest gas buyers are drawing up plans to switch to coal due to reduced gas flows from Moscow. Germany, for one, has signaled it could restart coal-fired power plants that it has aimed to phase out. The country's economic minister described the move as painful but necessary to help fill gas storage facilities for the winter. The Netherlands, meanwhile, has said it would remove a cap on production at coal-fired energy plants. Italy and Austria have also indicated that coal-generated power could help them weather an energy crisis. For Russia, the West only has itself to blame for the crisis after it imposed sweeping sanctions.
The head of the world's biggest airline trade body remains confident the industry will return to profitability in 2023. International Air Transport Association Director General Willie Walsh predicted air passenger volumes will hit 83% of pre-pandemic levels this year. He also sees industry losses dropping to less than $10 billion in 2022, a huge improvement from last year's $42.1 billion. But Walsh also noted turbulence remains on the horizon. These include the ongoing war in Ukraine. Walsh, for his part, laid down the difficulties.
If you look at the figures where we have said that losses now are likely to be in the order of 9.7 billion versus the 12 billion that we had originally predicted, that's in the face of a massive increase in the price of oil. And as you know, fuel represents the single biggest cost that an airline faces. So despite having that huge increase in the oil price, we have still been able to reduce the forecast loss prediction for this year. And I think that reflects not just the very strong demands we're seeing at the moment, but the expected demand development as we go through the year.
Sri Lanka has closed its schools and halted all non-essential government services as part of a two-week shutdown to conserve fast-depleting fuel reserves. The country is in the grip of its worst economic crisis in decades after running out of dollars to buy essential imports, including food and fuel. On Monday, it began in-person talks with the International Monetary Fund for a possible bailout. Three people are injured after Ukraine reportedly attacked Crimean oil drilling platforms in the Black Sea Monday. The head of Moscow-controlled Crimea says search is underway for seven others who remain missing. Ukraine has yet to confirm if it was responsible for the incident. The attack comes as Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky said they are engaged in complex negotiations to unblock grains trapped in Black Sea ports by Russia's naval blockade. The European Union has accused Russia of sparking a global food crisis due to its blockade, calling it a real war crime.
Ukraine acknowledging difficulties in the fight in its eastern region as Russia gains ground on two cities. President Zelensky says fighting has been the most difficult in Severodonetsk and Lysychansk. The governor of the Luhansk region, where those two cities are located, asserts Russian forces now control most of the Severodonetsk. Moscow's intensified offensive comes ahead of an EU summit this week, where European leaders are expected to officially welcome Kyiv's bid to join the bloc.
Russian journalist Dmitry Muratov auctions off his Nobel Peace Prize gold medal to benefit the children displaced by the war in Ukraine. The medal fetched a whopping $103.5 million. All proceeds from the sale will go to UNICEF's humanitarian response. Muratov won the prize in 2021 alongside Filipino journalist Maria Ressa for their efforts to safeguard freedom of expression. Muratov's independent newspaper, which is fiercely critical of Russian President Vladimir Putin and his government, suspended operations in Russia in March after warnings from the state over its coverage of the war in Ukraine.
Over in China, hundreds of thousands are evacuated amid the country's heaviest rainfall in decades. Rainfall in at least three provinces in southern China reached 621 millimeters. That's the highest since 1961. Residents in Shaoguan City are staying in schools converted into temporary shelters. All in all, officials say nearly 480,000 people are affected by the rains and floods across the country. The downpour has also swelled waterways in the Pearl River Basin, threatening China's manufacturing and shipping operations. Authorities peg the cost of damage so far at around $254 million.
The President of the United Nations General Assembly calls for collective action on hate speech. Abdullah Shahid says it has been worsening due to the spread of disinformation and fake news on social media. Shahid spoke in a special UN session on Monday to mark the International Day for Countering Hate Speech.
To address this challenge in a comprehensive manner, we must cultivate our global cooperation and stand united, embracing the collective spirit that this great institution was designed to foster and that hate speech seeks to completely undermine. Hate speech is an inherent threat to our values and principles.
A postponed trip to Africa has sparked a debate over the future of Pope Francis. An unscheduled meeting of cardinals in August has also fueled speculation the 85-year-old pontiff could step down. But at least one Vatican source told agency France Presse a resignation is highly unlikely. Pope Francis last week canceled a planned July visit to the Democratic Republic of Congo and South Sudan, citing knee problems. He has been suffering from pain in his right knee in recent weeks and has been seen in a wheelchair.
A sea of blue and gold floods the streets of downtown San Francisco as thousands of basketball fans join the victory parade of the Golden State Warriors. Romel Conclara tells us some Filipino fans even got an up-close and personal experience with the NBA champs.
Blue and gold confetti rained from the sky as the 2022 NBA champions Golden State Warriors paraded down downtown San Francisco. Steph Curry proudly showed off his first Finals MVP trophy, while other players like Draymond Green and Klay Thompson raising the Finals trophy they won in previous years. Then there were other players like Jordan Poole and Gary Payton II who gamely sprayed the crowd with water guns and even went down their buses to greet the fans up close. Tens of thousands of fans lined up the famous Market Street, stood on barricades, and even climbed up trees and street signs to get a glimpse of their champions. This Filipino family from Regina, Saskatchewan, Canada, now residing in the Bay Area, caught the attention of Canadian-born Andrew Wiggins.
Oh, that's a really big honor for us because he's carrying the Canadian flag. Yay!
And these Pinoys got a selfie with Wiggins and were even featured on his Instagram story.
Great feeling.
And the party continued several blocks away at District 6, an outdoor market and entertainment venue created by Philham entrepreneur Anthony Schlander.
So it means a lot to me that after the parade, there's about 1,000 people here. We're all celebrating, first, coming back together, second, the Warriors win, and man, it's just an amazing feeling.
The official Warriors hype man, Philham Franco Finn, says he was very proud of the Filipino turnout at the parade.
Man, that parade was 80% Filipino, I swear, in San Francisco. So whoever was there, thank you. Salamat. For those who are international, thank you. Being the first and only Filipino hype man, I wear this on my shoulders. This is for us.
You know, 75 years of the Warriors organization, this is their seventh title run. They had wins in Philadelphia, Oakland, and now in San Francisco. And the Bay Area is ready for more. Romel Conclara, ABS-CBN News, San Francisco.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Inside.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching. Now, a quick roundup of news you need to know. Outgoing Agriculture Chief William Dar expects a bigger budget for the agency, with President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. at its helm. A local research group sees daily COVID cases in Metro Manila hitting 1,000 next month.